welcome to my channel. I attended the Vintage Computer Festival in Berlin, where I gave a talk and hosted a small exhibition, both about Danish-built computers. The Vintage Computer Festival in Berlin consists of a bunch of retro geeks, a lot of old computers, and a venue kindly provided by the Deutsches Technische Museum in Berlin. There were rows and rows of old computers, and the best part was all the computers that I did not already know about. Some had brought back old and rare computers, some had built replicas of old mainframes, some had recreated their teenage room, and somebody just brought a beep load of Apple computers. Most exhibitions had a theme, but everybody had clearly put a lot of effort into their showpieces. The important thing, however, was networking. A lot of people connected with me at my stand, and I got a lot of contacts and potential content for my channel for years to come. Oh yeah, and I got invited back next year, and also invited to a couple of other festivals around Europe. I spent most of my free time the past 2 months preparing for this event. First, I had prepared a Piccolo computer from Regnecentralen, a CPM-based system with a Silex Z80 CPU and 2 floppy drives. It ran a couple of simple yet impressive games. Also from Regnecentralen, we had the Picoline and partner computers running concurrent CPM. We had some games who worked on the partner, but they were not really working on the Picoline, even though they should be compatible. They both used the Intel 8186 processor and had between 265 and 786 kilobytes of memory. Me and my friend spent a couple of weeks on building a translation machine, an Intel 386 computer which should be able to write floppies for the old machines. We called it Rosetta. And we actually managed to create a floppy with Zork and got it to work on our ICL Comet MPS 3000, which we also brought along. This is also a Danish produced computer with a Z80 processor, but this one is quite a bit rarer than the others. Anyway, this video is not about my computers. I will make separate videos about them later. This video is about my talk. I got a lot of compliments for my talk. Even though I made a lot of mistakes, I incidentally switched 2 of the Copenhagen suburbs and misspelled the name of the second ever Danish computer, but people liked it, so here you got it, almost unedited. And I need to give credits to the VCFB and C3 VOC teams who did the actual recording. Very skilled team. Enjoy the talk.
Hello and welcome. This talk will be in English. My name is Mike, and I like old computers, and I like communication. So I have started a YouTube channel about old computers. In that work, I got in touch with you guys and was asked to come here and talk a little bit about computers in Denmark. And my response was, we don't make computers in Denmark. We're too stupid to do that. And I was like, okay, I'll have a look. And then I found out so much that I had to cut away stuff. So we'll see if we can get through it. This talk is presented by the Danish Data Historics Association. We don't know what. It's a volunteer organization who gets very little pay from the government. Basically, they pay the rent. Everything else we pay ourselves. Those guys, which I'm part of, have lent me some machines and given me access to their archives. Danish Unix User Group, which is the green, white thingy down here, is a Unix user group. I'll talk more about them later. They paid a lot of the bill for us to get here with the exhibition, and my own company paid the rest. Let's get to it. In Denmark, right after the Second World War, the Americans wanted to help rebuild Europe. They did that by giving us a lot of money. And in Denmark, we decided to start a computer company for those money. We started the company called Regnecentralen. It was funded by the Americans mainly, and they started the computer company. What you see here is our Regnecentralen collection from the Data Museum. And I say Data Museum and Data Historic Society from time to time. That's the same thing. It's just 2 names for the same thing. We got this basement, and this is about 1/8 of the collection. And what you see here is the Rheinestralen part of the collection. This is a third generation computer, which means it's built with integrated circuits. So no CPU, but it's still running at 1 MHz clock frequency and have a whopping 128 kilobytes of memory, and only would take up about 60 square meters in your building, and that's not counting power supply and cooling. And another thing you see in the corner down here, this machine, this is actually the world's fastest card strip reader, which is also built by this company. And the reason why it's, I don't have to tell you, I guess, but it's the world's fastest strip reader because it was the last ever made, because people changed medias. But it was still cool. But let's get back to the beginning. The first machine we ever built was a copy of the Swedish computer BISC, but we are really bad at copying, so it ended up being not a copy, but being its own. It could add 17,000 numbers in a second. It had 5 kilobytes of hand-woven magnetic core memory. And this one took up an entire family house. They bought a family house in north of Copenhagen, and they used the basement as a workshop where they built the machine, and they used some of the garage for cooling, and they used the first floor for the computer, and then they used like a tiny space out in the corner of the place for what they will call the machine living room, Maskinstuen, where they would actually use the machine. This one weighed 3.5 tons, and they actually had to reinforce the building to keep it there. And this was the 50s, so we needed cooling. So what are we going to do? Yes, we're going to hook this up to the water supply from the city and just run it through. So it was water cooled, but the water, water wasn't recycled, so it was a mess, ecological speaking. And this machine, they planned that it would cover Denmark's needs of computation for at least 10 years. It lasted for 3. And then he started to building the next generation computers. This one was made with transistors. The first one was made vacuum tubes. Nanotubes is something else. and this one could fit in a wardrobe. And the first one, they only made one of those. So that was a one-off computer. This one actually got into serial production. We made 50 of those. And actually, one of them has survived to the day today. And we use that on holidays. We have one in our basement in the Data Museum. And we use it to celebrate holidays. And then we play the Christmas tune on this thing. And it takes like 10 minutes to play a 2-minute song. But it's still fun. So the reason why we started building this was that NATO wanted copies of the Danish maps in case that the East decided to invade, and they wanted to be able to find stuff. And in Denmark, when you have to say where something was, you would say, oh, it's 70 feet northwest of the church tower. And sometimes they forgot to mention which church tower. So they had to recalculate every position ever made in Denmark, and that was made by this machine. It's running at 0.45 megahertz, 200 kilobytes of storage, and this is 40 bit words and 2024 words. I had to, So this machine was actually more precise than 32 bit computers, which was the norm until like 15 years ago. We got one. It can play simple games. Games like, think of a country in Europe, and it will ask you, well, does this country have a border toward the sea? And you would say no. And then it would say, does this country have, I don't know. There's a lot of questions. So you ask 7 or 8 questions, and it will get a guess which country it is, and it will always be right unless you cheat. And it will assume you're right unless you cheat. And if you mention a country that didn't exist in 1965, you're also cheating. So, yeah. Anyway, this was just to get started. This is what defined Datacentralen in the 50s to the 70, from 1950 to 1975. All this has been based on non-microprocessor technology. When microprocessor came available, they started making computers that were, I won't say affordable, but schools and small businesses could afford these machines. The first machine is in our exhibition. That's a Piccolo. This is the Rheinstein Piccolo from 1979. It's a Z80 with 64 kilobytes of memory and two floppy drives. And this is something I'm going to say a lot because that is how you make a CPM machine. You could boot it. You had two operating systems for it. One of them was CPM and another one was Comal. Comal is a Danish software, it's a Danish programming language. And it's basically basic with some structure added on. So you can say go to line number 10, you have to make a label, and you can then say go to the label. And you can also say go sup to the label and add a return function so that you could actually do subroutines, which you know from modern languages. And this was that was made a bootable version of this so that you could actually just insert the disk and it will start directly into the programming language. And you could also make it start your program automatically, which means that you could actually sell those programs because you would just tell people, insert the floppy and turn on the machine. A couple of years later, they made the pair on the right. That is called a Picoline and a partner. And the Picoline is the one closest towards me. And those machines are basically IBM compatible computers, just not compatible. So it's the same hardware as you would expect in an IBM compatible computer. It's an 8186 Intel processor with about a megabyte of memory running at between 6 and 8 megahertz. That sounds like a PC compatible computer. But the engineers at Rheinmetall was kind of racist, so they were like, that sounds like IBM, that's bad, we're not going to use it. I don't have to say that they don't exist anymore, do I? That's should be obvious by now. But the machines were really awesome. If you compare them feature by feature to IBM PC from that time, they wiped the floor with IBM. I have one down there showing a demo where it does smooth screen scrolling and multitasking in a 186 computer. That's super interesting. Partner, that's more or less the same computer. Typically, you would sell 8 or 16 Picolini computers to a class and then sell them one partner, and the partner would act as a server. So you would only have to pay for this unit because that's where the CPU is, and this is the floppy unit, and those two cost about the same, around 10,000 kroners each. So that would be expensive to buy one for each student. So you would just buy one of the computing units and then use the partner to share a floppy drive or to share a 10, 20, or 40 megabyte hard drive, which was also exciting back then. And then last but not least, those machines built into the system, to the operating system, which was concurrent CPM, was also networking. So we are in the 1980s, in the beginning of the 1980s, and this set could also do ordinary networking. During the late 90s, they realized their fault and was like, no, the early 90s, sorry. They realized their fault and was like, oh, but we can make IBM computers too. Nobody cared. Then they said, oh, but we can make Unix computers too. And nobody cared either. They went bankrupt in 1993. I forgot to note that down. And got bought up by ICL, which is something which happens a lot in Denmark. We also had a company called Christian Rosing. Quick note, I'm not going to go much into details about him. Founded in 1963 in his parents' garage, made software for satellites, F-16 fighter jets, credit card systems, European Space Agency, NATO, NASA, and CERN. So he knew how to sell. And he knew how to build stuff, but he didn't know how to make a budget because he went bankrupt in 1984 and was sold off to ICL, among else. The company was split up in several bits, and ICL bought something, and a little bit of it lived on, and yeah, lots of boring details, but I just wanted to mention him because he got out in the world. You would actually be able to We didn't bring the machine because we didn't have room for it, but you would around in Europe be able to see computers from Christian Rausing or CR as they are noted. So if you see a computer which says CR on it, it's probably made in Denmark. Another Danish company built in 1975 by three engineering students built they built the first microprocessing processor computer. So this was meant for a small company, and you could actually hook up several terminals to it. We brought this one along. It's not working, but you can come and touch it if you want. It ran their own version of CMS. CPM, called Mikados. And this is a neat little machine. I don't know much about it because we are not allowed to turn it on. It's not mine. It would probably release the magic smoke if we turn it on. The company also made really super huge computers called Supermax, which utilized both Motorola 6800K, 6800 or 68K either, processors, and the RISC 4000 processor at the same time. So you could start up with the Motorola processor and write a software for that and realize this was too slow. And then you could buy a RISC processor and add to the same machine. And then you could run RISC software on the same machine while still running your Motorola software. And then you could easily port your software. And when once you got everything working, you could toss out the Motorola and add another RISC processor. So you would have two of those processors. That was, we have not found anybody else doing that in 83. Also, in around 83, we purchased Oracle. Not the company, not the software, but the source code. And they ported Oracle to their computers and exported the computers and the software to entire Europe and a little bit to Asia. Another fun note, I talked to the guy who did the porting of this. He told me that for $100,000, you would get the software, no, the source code, but not the comments. So you had to figure out everything by yourself. And how do you take comments out of C code? You could write a script that would remove everything starting with a hash mark, right? How do you make compiler tags in C? So the first release, they got, they stripped down all the compiler tags. So if you have to make a block of code that would be commented out for one processor and not for another, that would be a compiler tag, and those start with a hash mark as well. So they got a bunch of code that couldn't compile on anything. But they got a version with the compiler tags included and got it working, and eventually started sending patches back to Oracle. So and they added a lot of features which were not, they weren't allowed to, but they did it anyway, that Oracle first added years later. So this company was way ahead, but also went bankrupt and was sold to ICL in the 90s. So this, you were probably seeing a pattern. This computer, it's made by an engineer. That's a little bit more of my kind of people. One engineer that was just like, well, computers should be available to everybody. So he started an article series, can you say that, in a Danish computer magazine, where he would teach people to build this machine. I haven't read all the parts of the articles yet because they're hard to get by, but I am about 75% down and I need the last 25, and the office, the librarians are looking for that right now. But this machine started the process that ended up, led to this machine which we brought along. That's an ICL Comet MPS 3000. I'm not going to mention the specs because it's a CPM machine. Everybody knows by now that those have a Xilinx Z80 processor, 64 kilobytes of memory, yada, 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 yada. This one, however, could add a hard drive and you could add up to a megabyte of memory, which you could use as a RAM disk, or you could bank swap it into your memory. It was best to use it as a RAM disk because bank swapping was kind of expensive on this machine. They actually sold this as a multi-user system as well, I have one, but I'm not. I haven't gotten it to work yet. We have spent quite some time the last 4 weeks on figuring out how to read these floppies and write these floppies, so we could download software from the internet and put it onto the machine. And just 4 days ago, we got our machine to run SOC. Excuse me, but you hold up a sign that says 15 minutes.
15 minutes.
That's what I used, right? Okay, got. I was afraid you. Yeah, sure. I still have some slides left. Not many, but a couple. Anyway, so this guy built this himself, and then he voluntarily sold it to ICL before he went bankrupt. And ICL led the project and actually started developing new computers in the same series together with him. And they had a problem with the Commodore and the Amstrad computers, and those were took quite a lot of their market share. So they started developing a competitor, which was the ICL Comet 8, which is, I'm not going to mention the specs again, it's the same. However, this one was a little bit later in the process, so it had 3.5-inch floppy drives, and it actually had about 2 megabytes of memory divided up amongst some cache, some bank switching, some display memory, and a couple of other things. So almost 2 megabytes of memory, and they could be able to sell it for about the same price as a Commodore 64 back then. But we don't know what happened to it. ICL never canceled it, and they never released it. And we know we have found two places where they talk about it. One is in their own marketing material, and the other one is in an article from a computer magazine, which we didn't find ourselves. We got it mailed to us from ICL. So basically, ICL says they did this, but we don't know anything more about it. We are working hard to find that out. So what happened with this was that by this time the original engineer called Mogens Pelle, which is where the MPS comes from, he grew tired of ICL and started building his own computers and joined a company in Jutland. For you who doesn't know the geography of Denmark, there are the Copenhagen, which is the main area, who's situated on an island called Zealand. And in the entire opposite direction of a country, not counting Greenland, which is not a part of the country, but yeah, yada, yada, yada. We have Jutland, which is a main island, or the biggest island, depending on who you ask. And he moved over there and started developing new computers that was cheaper and with smaller companies. So he grew... it's hard because he won't talk to me about it. It's like he's have a... Yeah, he won't talk to me about it. I'm not going to speculate as to why. But he started building these machines. Not the one in the middle, but the one in the right is a Butler computer, which is the same again. Blah, 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 blah. Yeah, not much to tell. Well, of course, there are a lot of small details, but it doesn't matter in the whole big picture. This machine was built by Bokehir Datasystema in ECAST. The word doesn't mean anything. I have tried to find a meaning, but Bokehir, maybe Bok is Danish for books, and they also sell books, so maybe that's why. This is the first machine, and this is the second machine, the one on the right. Yeah. And we don't know much about that, these two machines, which is why I'm still working very hard at them, and they are connected to the ICL's comment story, which I'm very interested in. So I'm working on a lot of those. So we haven't even booted them. We're not afraid of booting them. The one in the middle, however, that is a real entrepreneurial story. That is called the Vega computer. Again, same specs as every other CPM computer. But this one was built by an electrical engineer who became a high school teacher, because what are you going to do with a master degree in the middle of nowhere, in the master of degree of electronical science on an island in Denmark, away from everything? But while working there, the government issued a commandment that we should start to teach computer science in high school classes and in technical schools. Yeah. We disagree because the guy who made them says 81, but the government says that his company didn't exist by then. It only existed 3 years later. And the guy who did it is 75 years old, and he insists that he remembers correctly. So I'm not done investigating that yet. Anyway, so his colleagues told him that that he should go and build some computers. And he was just like, no, do you realize how complicated that is and how long it takes? And so he did it in 6 months. He did it on his kitchen table with his wife as his only coworker, and they built 400 of these machines. I talked to this guy in the phone, and he sounded like an old man. And I was just like, "Excuse me, what did you say?" "Yeah, yeah," and he was totally clear. He didn't sound confused or anything. I was blown away. Come by my stand and see the machine. It's there and it's opened up. It's not booted, set to say. But this guy, he was so interested in the machine that he almost insisted that he would be allowed to come and help me fix it this fall. So that's what we're gonna do. I have heard a little bit up, so we are 5 slides left, and hopefully we'll catch up with the delay. So another story I wanted to bring along. This is a Danish Unix user group who's also sponsoring me, but I'm not more associated with them than that. They were founded in 1983 and were the first to connect Denmark to the internet. The University of Computer Science in Copenhagen, where they were allowed to place some equipment, had a phone dial-up line to, I don't remember, somewhere in Germany, and they added the first Danish node to the internet. In 1991, they added Hostmaster functionality, so you could buy Danish domains. And in 1993, they created the first commercial internet provider, so you could actually call the internet from Denmark and get mail and stuff. And they sold that to the local Danish telephone company in 1996 for 2.8 million euros. That's a lot of money for an organization with 20 volunteer geeks. So most of those money are still around. So if you have a great idea for something like, I don't know, drive to Berlin and do a talk at a vintage festival, you can write them a letter, say, hey, I need money. And then they paid us 15,000 Danish kroner. So we are very gentle. We're very thankful for that. And I think also that's an interesting story. It was basically 5 geeks who bought a 300 baud modem and connected Denmark to the internet. Today, if you want to connect anything to the internet, you need millions of dollars and digging equipment and fibers and stuff like that. We are also supported a little by the Danish Data Historic Society. This is also a little bit more than 5 old men, but yeah, well, I'm one of the youngest people in the crowd, and I just turned 37. So this is the people who actually worked with the machines in Rheinzentralen back in the 60s. And we have, I showed you just before the slide where you could see the collection. I could take 15 more pictures like this without having to take a picture of the same thing. This is how much space and how much junk, nice machines we have. They haven't contributed anything monetary, but I have borrowed a lot of the machines and I have used the library and it's a little bit hard to call them sponsors because I'm a member myself, so I'm sponsoring myself, which I'm actually doing twice because the company is also mine. So it's easy to be friends with yourself, right? Just to brag a little for some of you, that's not a lot, but that's my small collection. And that's also where I do my YouTube videos. If you see in the bottom there, I have an 80s looking backdrop and a shelf with a lot of the old computers and a little table. And then I place a camera in front and then I talk to the camera or blow up computers. I do that sometimes as well. My goal with this YouTube channel is to make enough money to be able to pay the rent for this nice facility. So that is why I would very much like you to tell all your friends to follow me on YouTube. Because we need a certain amount of followers before we can get any commercial entities to notice us. Yeah. So I'm finished 2 minutes before I planned. Questions? Okay. Oh, a question. Yeah, let me have it.
If I learn correctly, yeah? You can repeat that. If I learn correctly, then you have a trust of computer science people in Denmark for over 30 years. Is that correct?
So I was asked if we have if we had computer science people in Denmark more than 30 years back. It's more like 60. Because we built the computers in 1956, I remember, as far as I remember. They did that by sending a couple of electrical engineers to Sweden and look at what they did, and to Great Britain and look at what they did. Sadly, it didn't go to Germany because I don't know why. But they looked at their computers and went home and did the same in Denmark. And that would be, the birth of computer science in Denmark. So 1956, anybody good at math? So that would at least be 48 years. 84 years plus 19. 80, lots of years. Sorry about my math. I'm a computer guy. I use computers for math. Please like and subscribe. Thank you.
If you like this video, then please give it a thumbs up and don't forget to subscribe to my channel and hit the bell button to get notified when I publish new content. Also, if you want to help me out, please watch more of my videos right away. That tells the YouTube algorithm that you like my content and then it will promote my content even further. See you out there in the dark corners of the interwebs.